Father, thank you for this day, and thank you that you're already speaking. And I've been so encouraged by the words that have been shared through the songs, the prophetic words, Lord God, and it just really ties in with what you've given me today. So I just pray, Lord, that it won't be my words, Lord God, that's shared today, it'll be your words, Lord. And we just open our hearts to hear what you have for us all today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Hey, good morning, guys. My name is Kaide, for those of you who don't know me. And by the way, that picture with Janine and I, that was never meant to go out into the public. That's all. Literally, that's me. She said, Jacob, just take one for us. And somehow, well, I know how, we ended up with Tiva, I can't complain. I have put some interesting pics up in the past. So there we are. But just let you know, that's not the kind of thing I'm usually would do. What a shame. Absolutely. Well, the time for everything. Can you put the next slide up, please? Oh, have I got the clicker, by the way? No? Thanks, mate. Did any of you see this this week?
Yes.
It was really amazing, wasn't it? That was the Vice President Joe Biden in America, and he was presented with the Medal of Freedom by Barack Obama, and it was such an emotional time. He really couldn't believe that he's been awarded this great accolade. And in his speech, he said quite a few interesting things. But one of the things that was most poignant was he kept repeating the statement, "I don't deserve this, I don't deserve this." Do you remember that? And Barack Obama spoke these words over Joe Biden, you know, and just encouraged him and spoke about his life, his character, and all the great stuff he did. And I thought it was amazing. What it reminded me of is that one day we will stand before Jesus in a similar fashion, and we will have the opportunity to have Jesus speak over our lives and tell us and encourage us on the things that we've done for him and give us that medal of honor. You know, Tiva talked in Philippians 3 about the prize that we're running for, that eternal prize. And in order for us to get to that point where we stand before Jesus and hear him say those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant," we've got to understand the times and seasons that God has for us in our life in order to get to that point. And that's what this message is all about this morning. Because the Bible says in Psalm 37 that God cares about every detail of our life. Every detail. Isn't that amazing? Every single detail of our lives. You know, it's possible, and I've seen like this before, it's possible to live this life and hit the target. So hit the target, get a good job, hit the target, have a great family, hit the target, get involved in ministry, even in church work, hit the target, but miss the point of what God had for you and has for you in this life. But I really believe that in 2017, we don't have to miss the point. It's a new day, it's a new opportunity. And I really believe that God wants us to know the times and seasons that he's leading us into in 2017 and grab hold of that. And grab hold of all he has for us this year. You know, God's not a micromanager, but he is a master planner. But the amazing thing is, although God is a master planner, he gives us the opportunity to follow him or not, follow his plans or not. You know, last week Tina talked about the staff and how Moses had this staff which represented his finances, his future, his identity, and Moses had to release that staff to God. You know, for some of us, 2017, we need to release the plan for our life to God. And the reason why some of us feel like we're going in a circle and not getting anywhere, it's not that God doesn't love us, doesn't care for us, it's that we're holding onto the steering wheel. We don't quite know how to get there. But God is saying, release the steering wheel this week, know the times and seasons, and follow me into them. Amen. Amen. You know, I think it's so important that we know the times and seasons that God's leading us to for many reasons. One is, when we know the season we're in, we can measure success well. When we know why God has put us in a place at a certain time, we're not prone to frustration or irritation because we're thinking, well, I want to be here, but I'm not, I'm there. Because we know that we're exactly where God wants us to be. We're less likely to be frustrated and disillusioned. We can be at peace no matter the circumstances, when we know the times and seasons in our life. You know, the Bible says there is a time for everything. I really believe this. Because I said it really loud. But I really do believe it. That whilst it's not possible in this life to do every single thing we want to do, every single thing, I do believe it is possible to do everything God has called you and I to do in this life.
Yeah.
Absolutely. There is a time for everything. And we're going to look at Ecclesiastes 3, which is written by Solomon, King Solomon. And he writes this passage, and he lists lots of different seasons of life. We're not going to go through every single one, maybe for another time, but there are a few seasons that God had laid on my heart for us this Sunday. But these aren't the only things I believe that God has for us. You know, after this message, and my hope is that one, God will highlight areas in your life, my life, that he will speak to us about. But go back home, see God personally. I've been doing that for this year. God, what is the key life verse that you have for me this year? That's a good prayer to pray. What verse is the lens in which you want to live my life? And God spoke to me personally about that. He will do the same with you. A time for everything. And then we're going to somehow weave that through Exodus as well. That's the challenge that he was giving me. But it's a good challenge because Exodus is rich with that. So Ecclesiastes 3, a time for everything. And it's time I actually click this forward. There we go. Oh, that's small, isn't it? A time for everything. I'll let you guys get to Ecclesiastes 3. As I say, we're going to look at a few verses in Ecclesiastes 3 through the lens of Exodus. And last week, Tima gave this fantastic overview of Exodus in about 2 minutes. That was really good. I don't know if I can repeat that, but just briefly, Exodus is a book about transition and preparation. It's about the Israelites transitioning from a time of plenty when they were under a Pharaoh who was very favorable to them, to a time of slavery and hardship. It's a story about personal transition. Moses, who was born into slavery, raised in the Pharaoh's house as a prince, and then transitioned to be the leader of the people of Israel. It's a tale of transition when the Israelites then had to come out of slavery into the wilderness. God prepared them in the wilderness with the Ten Commandments. He prepared a place for his presence with the tabernacle, and Tiba linked that with the changes that God has put, leading us into in this place. And by the way, the tabernacle is only a mirror of the internal tabernacle that God wants to build. And it's a tale of transition as Moses comes from this really pitiful, scared, reluctant leader to one of the most significant people in the Bible. But the next one, a guy is raised up called King Solomon, who God gives wisdom, and in Ephesians 3 is the passage that we're going to look at today. Ephesians 3, time for everything. For everything there is a season. Ecclesiastes 3.
We'll picture it.
Ecclesiastes 3. That is terrible. That's such a bad English. I mean, like, I can't excuse it. It's so bad. I said that to you. Pick it up. I'm just deflecting. I said that to you last night. Quality control. Nothing. Miss. Excuse me. It was Tima, though. Certainly was Tima. Ecclesiastes 3. There's a time for everything. We can never watch that in the video. For everything there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. There's a time to plant and a time to harvest, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up, a time to cry and a time to laugh, a time to grieve and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace, a time to turn away, a time to search and a time to quit searching, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be quiet and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. There's a time for everything. Say everything with me.
Everything.
Great. I'm going to do that a few times today. I mean, considering you didn't have to stand up and chant and stuff, I'm sure you'll humor me with that. A time for everything. A time to be born and a time to die. Verse 2. You know, I'm not going to be talking about mortality and that kind of death, but it is an important thing to always keep in focus, isn't it, in this life, that we are born to die. And everything that we do in this life is leading up to the next life. But I'm not going to come from that angle in this section, the time to be born and time to die. You know, when Moses was born in Exodus, we see how he was born, he was rescued from death because the Egyptians wanted to kill all the baby boys, we know that. And he was rescued and put into the Egyptian palace and given a new life, wasn't he? But by the end of chapter 2, that whole life crumbles as Moses is put into exile, and that whole life kind of just dies, really. The father figure that he had, Pharaoh, that relationship dies. I imagine he would have been promised to a princess for marriage. That has to die. All the privileges that he had to die in order for him to move into this new life. And when he moves into this new life, God gives him a new father figure in Jethro. He gives him a new wife. He gives him a new purpose. But in order for him to walk into that purpose, he had to let some of that other stuff that he was used to, the life he was leading, die. You know, in the same way, we are born into a new life, aren't we? The Bible says that when we come to Jesus, the old is gone and the new has come. We're born into new life. But then there are areas in our old life which God wants to die. And the problem is, some of us, and I do this sometimes, we're bad at this. Instead of letting these things die, we kind of try and resuscitate them. Put them on life support, you know? But there are some things, some ways of thinking, some ways of acting, some habits and lifestyle that God wants you and I in 2017 to let die.
Yeah.
In order that we can come into the new life. Stop resuscitating those things. You know, I came out of living in the world, basically, like any regular guy. And I remember one day waking up and just feeling I wanted to go to a church. I went to a church, a bit like this, don't know what the sermon was about, went to the pastor, gave my life to Jesus, I knew things had changed. But they hadn't really changed in terms of what I was doing, but they changed in me. But I didn't realise how much until 2 weeks later. I was out in Essex, even though I lived in Birmingham, went out in Essex with some mates of mine, this is the kind of stuff we would do. And we went out, we had a bit too much to drink, and I got invited to the flat of this attractive girl. And that was, normally that was just the pinnacle of a night out, wasn't it? And you know, I just come out from the world, and I got to her flat. And I got into her flat, and then I suddenly felt inside, gosh, I don't want to be. This is something, it's just not quite right inside me. Something inside me had changed, something inside me had died. And I turned around to her and she's like, are you alright? Like, I think I'm going to go. She looked at me like, are you mad? What do you mean you're going to go? I start, you know what, I think I'm going to go. And she said, no, just stay. In fact, she said, just, I tell you what, we don't have to do anything. Just stay next to me in my bed and we won't do anything. I was like, no. No, that's not going to happen. I called up my friend Martin, and all the other lads were back at the flat. And I said, mine. He goes, yeah. He's like, I got it. I was like, no, mine. You've got to pick me up. He's like, yeah, what are you talking about, pick you up? These are Essex boys. London was like, what are you talking about, bruv? Pick you up. I was like, no, mind. Come and get me. He's like, are you mad? You pulled me. I was like, nah, come and get me. So he comes up, picks me up, takes me back. Guys are in bits, just laughing beside themselves. Tired. What are you doing? But the thing is, I didn't really care. I knew, as I sat there with all the guys laughing at me, that something had died inside me. Something had changed. And I had to let that thing die. I had to let that way of looking at relationships and sexuality die, because God was preparing me for a lady who somewhere was praying hard.
This was hold up.
He's preparing me for a new relationship. I had to let that die in order to walk into that new life. And so when Jim and I got together, it was, you know, and we both come from a worldly background, it was a case of I knew that area of life had died in me and I could walk with Ginny in a new way. and we could keep ourselves pure until our, you know, until our wedding night.
Oh, wedding night.
Anyway. Amen. Right, so
preaching.
There's a time to be born, and a time to die. You know, it's not just, you know, bad things, sins. You know, sometimes seasons come to an end. You know, and we got to recognize when a season comes to an end, not hold on to it, and let that season die. You know, I've been in sweet spots. You know, I remember I went into a job, and everything worked well. I was working with the people I wanted to work with. We were making, you know, good, delivering good projects. I was in my sweet spot. I thought, this is going to last forever. But then one day, I started to feel this shift in my heart that it felt like kind of grace had lifted for that ministry, for that job. Where I used to walk on water, it felt like I was wading in treacle. The stuff that gave me joy now started to give me a bit of heartache. And I started to say, God, what are you saying? I felt God was saying that season is coming to an end. You know, sometimes a season comes to an end, even in the middle of it being, you know, in a prosperous season. You know, in Mark 1, I think it's Mark 1, Jesus in the height of his ministry. Everyone wants to see him do stuff. And the disciples come out to Jesus and say, look, we've got a crowd out there for you, ready for you. Come on, showtime. And Jesus says, actually, that season is over. We've got to go to the other towns and cities, for that is why I came. Because Jesus knew the times and seasons that God has had for him. You know, it's important we stay sensitive with God to know the times and seasons that he has for us. You know, sometimes God puts an unexpected roadblock in our path. And he puts the cones there. He puts the barriers there. And the reason why he does that is not because he wants to stop us from progressing, because he knows what lies ahead. You know, a couple of weeks ago, I was driving to a meeting and up the A30. And I came up, I was going really well. And I came up to this roadblock near Launceston, and there were cones, there were men standing there, do not pass. And I was really frustrated, but I thought, I'm going to stick to what they've said. I'm going to carry on down the diversion until we get back on the road. And I saw another guy speeding up, and there was a barrier that said, do not pass, and he just went straight through. He went straight through, and it looked like he was progressing really well. I thought, oh, well done you. But a few minutes later, I see that same car turn back around and come all the way back and join the queue right at the back. You see, he thought that he could just get through that barrier, it'd be all right. But what he didn't anticipate is at the end of that road, there was no road. And so he had to come back around and waste all that time just to get back on again. You know, I feel like sometimes God puts a roadblock in our life. It might be in a relationship, and it might be, you know, it might be in a job, it might be in something we're going to do with our finance. There's a roadblock, he puts cones, he sends men and women, say, do not pass. But we're just a bit of, I don't know, pride or arrogance, we just drive straight through it. But actually, God is saving us from trouble further on ahead. And what happens is we just waste time, because at the end of the day, we get to the point where we realize, oh, that's why God said, you know, and you've got to retrace your steps. You know, I believe in 2017, God is saying where he's put roadblocks in your life, just let it die. Trust him. Trust him. Trust him. Just take a moment, and I just want to do this for this and then the next couple of points. Take a moment, would you just consider a prayer in your heart, ask God, even just maybe close your eyes for a moment, and God, what areas of my life this year do you want to die? What seasons are over, and you want me to stop trying to resuscitate? Let the Holy Spirit just lift them up. There might be an attitude. There might be an area of maturity. You know, Paul says, when I was a child, I thought like a child, I acted like a child. When I became a man, I put childish things away. It might be a habit that spiritually has died, but you're letting the flesh take over. What is it that God, there might be a season that's coming to an end, God's saying, stop hankering after that season. Let it die. and take the goodness from that time into the new season I'm leading into. It's a time to die. A time for everything. A time to kill and a time to tear down. We talked about the fact that there is a time to die. There are things that we just need to let die. But God revealed to me that there are things in our life this year that God wants us to actively kill. Not just let dissipate, but take the front foot. You know, Matthew 3 verse 10, Jesus says, even now the axe of God's judgment is poised. He's ready to sever the roots of the trees. Yes, every tree that does not produce good fruit, we chop down and thrown into the fire. You know, there are trees in our lives that we've allowed to grow that don't produce any good fruit, and they're only good for the fire. They're only good to be chopped down. Anger, gossip, unforgiveness, fear, apathy. There are actions, pornography, lustful relationships, harsh words, which are only good for the fire to be killed. There are giants in our life that intimidate us and stop us from walking into the next phase of, in our life. And you know, later on in Numbers 13, we see the Israelites coming to the cusp of entering into God's promise. Get the analogy from this. And these giants are in there in the land, and God is basically saying to them through Joshua, kill these giants, but a lot of them get scared and pull back and allow those giants to stop them walking to God's promise. You know, there are giants in our life. The same kind of giant that David faced in the story, well-known story of David and Goliath, that intimidate us, that mock us, that God wants you and I to actively kill. And I love David, the story of David. He throws a stone, he knocks out Goliath. That probably would have been enough, but he wanted to make sure. He runs up, gets his sword, he cuts his head off. Dead. You know, there's some things that God wants you to make dead. I don't know if it doesn't make grammatical sense, but you know what I mean. Dead. Don't just stun it, kill it. You know, for Moses in Exodus, his issue was anger. And in Exodus 2, in a fit of rage, he killed an Egyptian. And he flees. You know what? God had to kill that spirit of anger within him. Because God knew that Moses' call was one day to lead a million grumbling people through the desert. He couldn't kill them all, you know what I mean? Moses couldn't just, you know, turn around and kill every single person that irritated him. You know, it took 40 years for Moses, apparently for 40 years from him being exiled from Egypt to come back as their leader. And some people say, wow, man, it took a long time for God to call Moses. Moses was waiting for God for a long time, but I don't think that's the case. I think God was waiting for Moses to kill that spirit of anger, that rage. And when he did, it was time for him to step forward. You know, there are some things that you and I have got to kill this year. You've got to kill them. You've got to kill them. You know, I love that, we're out of time. Do you remember in, anyone watched the Chronicles of Narnia?
Yeah.
Well, every Christian's watched that, haven't they? But there's a scene in the Chronicles of Narnia when Aslan, the Christ-like figure, gives Peter a sword, and Peter's face, that the wolf is his adversary, he's faced him before, and the first time he faces it, Peter bottles it, doesn't do anything, gets scared, and then he faces that same wolf again. And this time Aslan's there next to him, but Aslan says to Peter, I'm not going to do this for you. I'm giving you the sword, this is your battle. And Peter stands there terrified, but he kills the wolf. And then he steps on into the next phase of life. You know that God has given us weapons of warfare. The Bible says, 2 Corinthians 10, we have weapons, mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We've got the word of God, it's a double-edged sword.
Yeah.
It's a weapon God has given you. Yes, he's like Aslan, he's standing there, he's not going to let you fall, but there's some battles he wants you to fight with the weapons he's given you. Some things he wants you to kill.
Romans 8:13, if you live by the dictates of the flesh, you will die. But if through the power of the Spirit you put to death the deeds of your sinful flesh, you will live. You will live.
You know, a few years ago, I think I was 23, 24, I had the opportunity of, I was asked actually to come into a role, a ministry role in a fairly large church in Birmingham. And it was a privilege for me to work with some ministers that I looked up to all my life. And I was so excited about this thing. But unfortunately, there was some politics behind it, which I didn't understand. And I walked into a lion's den. And this role just didn't really materialize. It crumbled. And I was devastated by this thing. And I saw some of the guys who I respected all my life behave in ways that I never thought they would behave, and it was tearing me up inside, and I had the opportunity to complain about it, I could have taken them to task. But you know what? One day I was just listening to God, and I felt to myself, look, Kaida, I said to myself, Kaida, if you don't kill this bitterness, this anger inside you, it's going to follow you for the rest of your ministry. If you don't deal with this now, this is going to hold you back. And so I went up to the lead minister, and remember, you know, this has been, you know, quite a difficult thing. And I came up to him. He looks a bit nervous. What's God going to say to me? I said, I'm going to change this thing. I said, Derek, I forgive you. I forgive you. And he looked at me a bit shaken. And I said, it was a very difficult time, wasn't it? I said, yeah, I forgive you. I said, I'm going to serve you. Whilst I'm here, I'm going to serve you. And I started just getting involved again, getting involved in stuff, and to a man, prompted by the Holy Spirit, without me doing anything, each one of those guys, ministers, came up to me and unreservedly apologized for what happened. And I was healed. But I had to kill it right there and then. Because I knew it would follow me. You know, there are areas, pains and hurts, that some of us have come through. And the devil is so wily, he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And you can't sit back, you've got to be proactive. You've got to kill that bitterness. Yeah. You've got to kill that habit. You've got to cut it dead. Because when you do, then God can bring new life. You know, I'm not keen gardener, but I do know there are some plants that when they die, you just leave them there, they'll be good fertilizer, you know. There's some things that... We've experiences we go through, we can leave them there. It's okay, we learn from it. But there's some things like ivy, which you've got to rip out, because if you don't, it will choke all the other life in the garden. And I feel there's some things in our life that God is saying, you've got to kill it this year.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it will choke my plans and purposes for you. But I've given you the weapons to cut them down.
Yeah, come on.
This is the year that you're going to kill that thing. A time for everything. A time to kill. A time to kill. Let's take a moment. Let's just ask God. What things, God, do you want us to kill this year? What attitudes? For some of us, I think that there are family feuds that have lasted for maybe generations, for years and years, and God is saying, you've got to kill that this year. You've got to kill that. There are habits that have plagued you. But God is saying, this is the year that will be killed. The hurts have run deep. And you think, well, I need to be defensive. But God says, go on the offensive with that hurt. I'm going to give you the weapons to kill it. And then you're going to see new life come from where there's been death. A time to kill, and there's a time to heal. And then the healing comes after you've killed that thing, that issue. There's a time to kill. We're running out of time. There's a time to plant. A time to plant and a time to harvest. You know, Exodus is all about preparation, isn't it? It's all about preparation. You know, Moses was prepared in the wilderness. You know, as a shepherd, God was planting character in him, wasn't he? Probably didn't make sense at the time when he was leaving all those sheep. But God knew that if he could handle crazy sheep, he was going to handle crazy people. There's a time of preparation, and You know, in Exodus 3, we see where Moses first throws down the staff that Tima talked about last week, and it turns into a snake, and the Bible says that Moses runs away from the snake. But by Exodus, I think Exodus 7, Moses is standing in front of Pharaoh, he throws down the snake, this time he doesn't run away, and his snake eats the snake of the Pharaoh's sorceress. And through that preparation time, Moses grows. You know, in Exodus 2, Exodus 3, when God calls Moses, he says, "No, I can't speak." But by chapter 20, he's standing in front of a million people giving them the Ten Commandments. There's a time for preparation. You know, in this kind of instant culture, so often I find myself in this kind of mode. We want things straight away, don't we? You know, there's some things that God's put on our hearts, and I want it now, and that's a good thing to do. But, you know, God is not an instant coffee God. He's a slow brew type of guy, you know? If you've got a cafeteria at home, you put the coffee in, you put the hot water, you leave it, all the impurities come up, scoop up the impurities, put the milk in, you drink it. It takes a bit of time, but it's good. In the same way, God works like that with us. He gives us a call, he gives us something in our heart. It might be a relationship, it might be that it's a ministry, it might just be a job, whatever it is. And often he prepares us for it. He lets the impurities bubble up so he can cleanse us of that, so that we can walk in purity into this new thing. Because I've heard it said that gifting will never take you where character cannot sustain you. And God wants you to be successful, and that's why he lets us go through preparation, even painful preparation. I remember a few years ago I wanted to join this football team. It was a quite high level team in Birmingham. They had two teams, and my goal was to get into the squad of the second team. And I remember going to the pre-season, and the coach was saying to us all, to loads of us, "Look, guys, we've got to have a tough pre-season. You're going to work hard, but if you stick to it, we'll be as fit as you ever was. So I'd go to the pre-season, and we'd run up hills, run down hills, we'd do all this kind of fitness training, and I was like, when are we going to get football out, you know? When are we going to get a chance to show our skills? And sometimes the training didn't seem to be in line with the actual game of football. I remember it came to the time where the squads were going to be selected, and I was thinking, come on, get the squad, second team squad. And I was just milling around with some of the players, and the manager comes up to me and says, and it's the first team manager, I think, what's he doing? He said, "Look, Kyle, come over here." And I said, "What is it?" He said, "Here's a shirt." So, what do you mean? Because you're in the first team. First team squad? No. You're the first team. You're starting. And he said, "You know, the coaches and I, we've watched you in pre-season. We've watched your attitude. We've watched how you've applied yourself, how you've dug deep, worked hard. We saw something in you. You're in the team." You know, I really believe that in the same way, sometimes God sends us, and I think like Deb says, a bit on a trail, and sometimes it looks like a bunny trail, where God leads us down different paths, and sometimes we're thinking, confused, why is God doing this? But what God is looking for is the way that we respond to his plan. How we respond to the challenge, how we respond to the offense.
Yeah, that's good.
And when he sees that, he sees our heart, he then thrusts us into the harvest. A time to plant and a time to harvest. You know, before I even got involved in this stuff and preaching, whatever, I remember I was given this prophetic word about preaching and teaching, and I thought, well, I haven't even preached a sermon. I don't know what I'm doing. No one's giving me this opportunity. And I remember speaking to a preacher, and I said, "Look, what do I do?" And he said, "I'm going to pray for you." And he came back to me and said, "God has spoken to me," and he says to Kaide, "You, Kaide, develop the man, and I, God, will develop the gift." And I just dropped all the preaching stuff. I stopped chasing it, stopped thinking about it, and for 5 years or so, I just got involved in church as normal, as regular, and I never saw that lesser anyway. And in God's time, I think it was 2011, actually, Andy Ollerton in Penzance said, "Kaide, do you want to preach one day?" "Do you want to preach?" I was like, "Okay. Let's do this." God gave me that opportunity. I'm still learning, man. Thank you, guys. You guys are so gracious as I can develop with you guys. I'm still learning, absolutely. I'm just starting out. But there's a time to prepare. There's a time to plant and a time to harvest. You know, when God is preparing us, let's not... The Bible says, do not look down at the days of small beginnings. The worship team come up. I had so much more I wanted to say. My time is running out. Crazy time. And I want to finish with good time, although I've probably gone over time. A time for everything. There's a time to die this year, and it's a good day. Let those things die. It's a time to kill. God's giving you those weapons, and there's a time to plant. You know, God's preparing each one of us right now for the next season of life. It might be having a family. It might be a new relationship. It might be you're in between seasons, in a ministry, in a job, or whatever, and God is preparing you. And all the stuff that's gone behind is going to propel you into this next thing. Because when it's a time to harvest, I felt like God was saying, when it's time to harvest, go for it. Don't hold back. You know, Jesus rebuked a tree, poor tree, in the Bible, because it was time for fruit, and it didn't have any fruit. You know, I talked about preparation, it's so important, but there will come a time where God is saying to each one of us in different areas of life, now is the time for harvest. Now is the time to share the gospel with that friend that you've been befriending for many years. Now is the time to invite that person to sparkle. Now is the time to step up into that ministry that God's calling to. Now is the time to move on to this new relationship. And when God calls us into that, let's go for it. As a church, as God is preparing us, as God is killing things in us that should be there, as we're dying to self, there will be times where God is saying, now, time to harvest, let's go for it. When God calls us into that. It's a time for everything. You guys can kick off. Not literally. I just want to finish with this. I started off with a time to born and a time to die, and I finished with that. You know, in the Gospels, Jesus talks to a really clever man called Nicodemus about what the kingdom of God was all about. And this guy is saying, says to him, Jesus, I want this. And Jesus replied to him was, well, you've got to be born again. In other words, you've got to be born spiritually, not physically again. You know, the Bible also said there's only one way to God, and that's through Jesus. And I'm unashamed in giving this opportunity this Sunday. We do every Sunday. You know, this offer to us to walk in line with God for an eternal destiny, to walk in His great plans, it's offered to everyone freely today. And for some of us, maybe the time is now to say to God, I'm going to let go and let you in my life. So I want to give two calls as we just bow our heads in prayer. If there's anyone here who has heard God's word, heard Him speak to you, and you want to say yes to Jesus, I want to die to myself and I want your new life in me for the first time. Or if there's someone who's been walking with Jesus and has deviated from His path spiritually, and you want to say, I want to get back on path with you, Jesus. I just want you to, just as everyone's eyes are closed, raise your hand just so I can see and pray for you. If you want to say yes, see that hand. Anymore. If you want to say yes to Jesus, I want this, I want to walk in this plan. I've heard your word. Anymore. You're not coming to me, you're coming to Him. Father, I pray for that individual's hands are raised. I thank you that whoever calls in the name of God will be saved. I don't know his circumstances, but I know that you love him and you've got a plan for his life. And right now, Jesus, we just believe in faith that walk starts today. That declaration of faith has been heard by heaven. And we declare a great plan for you, for your life. But the old is gone, then. As you reach out to Jesus, all sins, all the past is gone. And a new life you're walking into. In Jesus' name. And I'd love to pray for that individual. And finally, you know, as we're worshipping, I just want to do a last invitation. As I'm preaching, if there's areas in your life where the Holy Spirit specifically highlighted to you to die this year, to kill, to plant, and you want to, maybe that's just as a response to God, say, yes, I want to give that to you. I invite you to spaces, come forward, and just lay that before Jesus. There's some people who are here to pray for you if you want. Don't want to pray for you, that's fine. But I invite you to just come forward. I'm going to be there with you. And commit to the times and seasons God has for you in 2017. There is a time for everything. The time is now.